Hello everyone, I'm Tako Boris from University of Roma Tre, Italy, and I'm going to present SHealS and HealS isogeny-based PKEs from a key validation method for SIDH. This is a joint work with Christophe Petit from University of Bruxelles and University of Birmingham. The security of the cryptographic protocols we use today rely on integer factorization and the discrete logarithm problems. But as we all know, the Petit algorithm designed in 1994 can solve this integer factorization problem and the discrete logarithm problem in polynomial time using a quantum computer. In 2016, NIST launched a standardization process at the end of which new post-quantum secure cryptographic protocols such as key encapsulation mechanisms and signatures will be chosen. So today we start at the third round of the competition and the hard problems underlying the security of the schemes in this third round come from lattices, codes, multivariate, isogenies, and hash base. Isogeny-based protocols have the advantage that they provide very compact keys and the disadvantage that they are relatively slow compared to other candidates. And isogeny-based cryptography in general is a very young field. SIDH, which is the building block in psych, uses supersingular isogenies, and in general, supersingular isogenies do not commute. To make the diagram commute, because SIDH is a Diffie-Hellman type key exchange, so to make the diagram commute in SIDH, Jao and Defeo, they publish images of some torsion points. There have been several attacks that exploit these torsion point images, among which we have the passive attacks of Petit and recent improvement, and the famous GPST adaptive attack on SIDH, and the recent new adaptive attack on SIDH by Petit and I. SIDH, which is the only isogeny-based scheme engaged in the NIST standardization process, uses the Fujisaki-Okamoto transform to counter the GPST adaptive attack. Using this transform implies that there is key disclosure and re-encryption. The key validation method used in the scheme is public key re-encryption. So at least like recompute the public key of Bob to make sure that Bob honestly computed is public key. There have been other variants to the GPST adaptive attack, among which KSIDH, which consists in running multiple instances of SIDH in parallel, and the recent paper by Defeo et al. And co-authors, which designs a proof of isogeny knowledge, This is a signature scheme from which that Bob can use to prove that he computed an isogeny of the correct degree, and the torsion points in his public key were also computed honestly. The problem about the issue with KSIDH and the recent proof of isogeny knowledge is that these countermeasures are costly. So there is a lot of computations to be done, and the keys are also very large. So in this paper, what we do is that we suggest a new countermeasure to the GPST adaptive attack, and we incorporate this countermeasure into an interactive key exchange protocol. We also derive two INCCA secure PKEs, SHealS and HealS, with conjecture INCCA security. This talk will be organized as follows. First, we will talk about elliptic curves and isogenies. Next, we'll describe SIDH and the GPST adaptive attack. We will then present our countermeasure, present the key exchange HealS site, the public key encryption scheme SHealS and HealS, and we will summarize our contribution. So elliptic curves are smooth projective algebraic curves of genus 1, and when the characteristic of the field of definition of the curve is different from 2 and 3, then every elliptic curve is isomorphic to a short Weierstrass curve. Isomorphism classes of elliptic curve are determined by the G invariant. So the G invariant is the invariant of isomorphism classes of elliptic curve. Every elliptic curve has a unique abelian loop structure, and for a prime and for any integer n coprime to the characteristic of the field of definition of the curve, the n-torsion group is a dimension 2 free group. That is, the n-torsion group is generated by two linearly independent points of order n. Over finite fields, there are only two possibilities for the endomorphism ring of analytic curve, and this endomorphism ring can be either isomorphic to an order in an imaginary quadratic field, in which case we say that the curve is ordinary, or to a maximal order in the quaternion algebra ramified at P and infinity, in which case we say the curve is supersingular. Isogenies are maps between elliptic curve, and they are also morphisms with respect to the group structure of the elliptic curve. Isogenies are given by value formulas, and their degree is up to some precision the size of their kernel. Isogenies, when their kernels are given, they are efficiently computable. When their degree, isogenies of given kernel are efficiently computable when their degree is smooth, and we don't know how to compute them efficiently when their degree is not smooth. The pure isogeny problem is the following: given two isogenous curves E1 and E2, compute an isogeny phi from E1 to E2. This ends the part about elliptic curves and isogenies. One should note that this pure isogeny is not always the concrete problem underlying the security of isogeny-based schemes. And in the case of SIDH, you have more information. You don't only have E1 and E2, but you also have the action of phi on some torsion points. So let's present SIDH. So SIDH is a Diffie-Hellman type D exchange. So since you have elliptic curve and isogeny, what you would expect to do is to start with some elliptic curve E0. You compute secret isogenies, then you exchange the public curves, and you compute some other secret isogenies to obtain the shared secret. But as we stressed before, supersingular isogenies, they don't commute in general, so you don't know how you do. You don't know how the isogeny phi b or phi a prime are defined, and you don't expect to have the same shared curve. So what Zhao and Defeo do in their scheme is that they provide torsion point images that will help at least to push through the kernel of the isogeny phi A through phi B without knowing phi B. Bob will also reveal some torsion points. Alice will also reveal the images of some torsion points that will help Bob to push through the kernel of his isogeny through phi A without knowing phi A. And having pushing these kernels through secret isogeny will help to make the diagram commute. So now we have E0 and the respective torsion group basis. Alice computes her secret isogeny and evaluates her secret isogeny on Bob's torsion group basis. Bob does the same, and the public keys are the curves and the respective torsion point images. Now with these torsion point images, they can make the diagram to commute, and they obtain the same shared curve, which can be used as the shared secret. So the shared secret here is the G invariant of this curve. Since SIDH is a Diffie-Hellman type key exchange, then we have the key recovery problem, the computational Diffie-Hellman problem, DDH problems, and so forth. So here we present the key recovery problem and the computational Diffie-Hellman problem. So the key recovery problem is the problem of computing an isogeny when its action on some torsion points is given. So here you are given E0 and EA, the torsion points PB, QB, and their image is true. Phi A, and you are asked to compute phi A, or equivalently, the kernel of phi A, or the integer alpha that defines the kernel of phi A. The computational Diffie-Hellman, you are given the curve E0, the curve EA, and the curve EB, together with the respective torsion point images, and you are asked to compute the shared secret. So here we will be interested in the first problem, that is the supersingular isogeny problem with torsion points that in an adaptive attack setting. So we suppose that you are given access to a key exchange oracle and you want to recover alpha. That leads us to the GPST adaptive attack. So in the GPST adaptive attack, one supposes that at least the first participant in the key exchange has a static key and is honest, and there is a second participant, Bob, who is malicious and wants to recover Ali's secret. So one also supposes that he is given access to a key exchange oracle that has inputs E, R, S, and E dash, where E, R, S stands as the public key of Bob in the SIDH instance, and E dash is some random supersingular curve that Bob wants to check if this is the shared curve in the SIDH instance or not. Obtain the shared curve computed by Alice in the shared in the SIDH instance or not. So the oracle will return one if this curve, if E prime, E dash is the shared curve computed by Alice in the SIDH instance, and zero if not. The idea of the attack is to progressively recover each bit of the secret alpha from the least bit to the most significant bit, by replacing the torsion points in Bob's public key by some maliciously computed ones. And when querying the oracle, Bob will distinguish whether the curve computed by Alice is the curve he obtained or not. And with this, Bob can guess which bit, what is the bit of, what are the bits of alpha. So in the very first version of SIDH, the only key validation method was the pairing check. So these points RI and SI are chosen such that the pairing check equation is successful. And they are also chosen such that the curve obtained by Alice equals the curve computed by Bob when the bit Bob is attacking is one, and is different when the bit Bob is attacking is zero. That is, the key exchange oracle will effectively help Bob to distinguish whether the bit he's attacking is one or zero. With this, you can totally recover alpha in polynomial time. And this is the main reason why in psych, you use Fujisaki Utamoto transform to counter this adaptive attack. Now, the other, as we said before, the other countermeasures suggested are very costly. So we will now suggest a new countermeasure to the GPST adaptive attack. Note that in SIDH, as far as Bob only scales the images of his torsion points by some integer lambda coprime to the order of the torsion points, this will not affect the execution of the scheme. This will not affect the curve, the shared curve, and the isogenies computed in this scheme. So we start by noticing that our countermeasure starts by noticing that the isogenies, they commute in reality. I think this is a note by Leonardi, Christopher Leonardi, saying that when you use the value formulas, the isogenies, in fact, they commute on evaluation, not only on the end curve, but on evaluation. So composing this equation by the dual of phi a dash, you get 2 to the a times phi b equals phi a dash, the dual of phi a dash composed with phi b dash composed with phi e. This equation implies that if Alice would magically compute the right hand side of the equation, then he could also manage to compute phi b on some torsion points. So if Ali has the action of phi b dash on some torsion points, then he can evaluate the action of phi b on the same torsion points. But there is this integer 2 to the a in the equation, which will sort of kill the torsion point to the at least 2 to the a part of the torsion point. So what we do is that we use points of order 2 to the 2a, such that the 2 to the a will kill only the 2 to the a 2 to the a part of the torsion point, and you will be left with a free 2 to the a, another 2 to the a part when verifying this equation. So you choose P2 and Q2 such that 2 to the a P2 equals to PA, 2 to the a Q2 equals to QA. Then the equation translates to phi B of PA, which is phi B of 2 to the a P2, is phi A dash dual composed with phi B dash composed with phi A of P2. So here P2 has order 2 to the 2A. So if both can reveal the action of phi B dash on points of order 2 to the 2A, then at least can compute phi A dash dual composed with phi B dash composed with phi A of P2. Hence, she can obtain phi B of PA. The same for Q2 and QA. So why would Bob honestly compute phi B dash? Let's go back to SIDH. So if you look here, we will see that phi B dash is normally, should normally be the push forward of phi A, of phi B dash should normally be the push forward of phi B through phi A. So if you include some maliciousness in phi B and you want like to use phi B dash to cancel the maliciousness you included in phi B, then you will need to know the action of phi A on the torsion group you are manipulating. And Bob is manipulating the torsion group of order, the torsion group of order 2 to the 2 to the A torsion group. So he will need to know the action of phi A on the 2 to the A torsion group. Hence, he needs to know at least secret, because the action of phi A on the 2 to the A torsion group is equivalent to knowing the at least secret. So here, to sort of maliciously compute phi B such that the equation or the diagram stays commutative, at least in some cases, what we need to do to know phi A. So that's the intuition why Bob should not mess up with phi B dash. So yes, we have already explained this, and this also, and we explain why Bob should not mess up with phi B dash. So now let's concretely present the countermeasure. So we are revealing the action of isogenies through many points, too many torsion groups, and so there many points will be involved here, and if you don't get it from the first presentation, then don't blame yourself. I think I also will not be able to get it from the first presentation. So let's start then. At the beginning, now you have P2, your points P2, Q2. You also have PB and QB for both torsion points. Now, Bob will be revealing isogenies of the will be revealing the action of phi B to P2 and Q2. P2 and Q2 have order 2 to the 2A. And the isogeny of Bob is 3 to the B, which is roughly 2 to the A. So the scheme is imbalanced, and to counter the Petit torsion points attack, which applies on imbalance SIDH, we set the endomorphism ring of the starting curve to be. On, we set the starting curve E0 to be a supersingular curve with unknown endomorphism. So now, Alice will compute phi A and the images of Bob torsion points. She will also compute phi A, evaluate phi A on P2 and Q2, and keep this secret. She will generate a canonical 2 to the 2A torsion basis of EA, and compute the coordinate of these points in this canonical basis. And she will add these coordinates to her secret key. Bob evaluates phi B on P2 and Q2 to obtain RASA. He evaluates phi B dash on the canonical basis RASA to obtain RABSAB. He publishes, he sends his public key and this RABSAB to Alice. When Alice receives When Alice receives RAB and SAB, she evaluates psi A on RA and S and SA to obtain the shared curve and distortion points. Note that here we just note psi A just to highlight that Bob would have been malicious, then this would not possibly, this will possibly not be the push forward of phi A through phi through phi B. That's why we denote it by psi dash instead of phi A dash. So with this information, Alice can now run the key validation. She first of all checks the pairing equation on the torsion points in Bob's public key. Then she computes, she checks if phi A dash of RA equals to E1 RAB plus F1 SAB. Note that phi A dash of RA, psi A dash of RA stands for phi A composed with phi B of P2. And E1 RAB plus F1 SAB here stands for phi B dash composed with phi A of P2. So she's like checking if phi, she's like checking this equation. So she's like checking this equation, which corresponds to phi A dash composed with phi B equals to phi B dash composed with phi A on the 2 to the 2A torsion group. So if all the checks are correct, then Bob's public key, then Bob's torsion points are harmless, then the key is valid. And if the checks are not correct, then Bob is certainly malicious and the key is invalid, so she can abort the key exchange. Now let's see how to incorporate our countermeasure in a key exchange protocol. We present his side. So the aim here is to derive a key exchange from the key validation we have just presented. Note that in the key validation, Bob publishes the images phi B dash RA, phi B dash SA of the points RA and SA. And these points lie on the shared curve. So if you publish torsion point images in clear, then an adversary can use the torsion points to recover the shared curve. What we do is that instead of publishing these torsion point images in clear, you generate a canonical basis of the 2 to the 2A torsion of EAB, and you publish the coordinate of this point in this canonical basis. The scheme is interactive because this information needs to be done, needs to be shared online. It cannot be pre-computed. So the key generation is the same, just that now Bob also uses points of order 3 to the 2B instead of 3 to the B only. Alice generates as public and secret key pair as in the key validation. Bob does the same. Now to perform the key exchange, Alice computes isogeny phi A dash, and she also computes the images of the canonical 3 to the 2B torsion group of EB that Bob will use in his key validation. And she will publish the coordinates of this torsion point in a canonical basis of EBA. Bob does the same as in the key validation. Now with these coordinates that are published, each party can run the key validation. Alice will run the key validation on her side as presented previously. Bob will also run the key validation on his side. And if the checks are correct, then each party was honest, they will have the same shared key, which will be valid. And if the checks are incorrect, then one of the parties was malicious and they will abort. They will both abort the key exchange. So the interactive part here is the part in which these coordinates are computed and sent through the public channel. So what about the security of Hill site? The computational Diffie-Hellman problem is the following. You are given E0, EA, and EB, and the respective torsion point images. But you are also given the coordinates of some torsion points on the shared curve in some canonical basis. And you are asked to compute the shared curve. The difference between the computational Diffie-Hellman problem in SIDH, first is that the instance is imbalanced because you have points of order 2 to the 2a, while you are computing isogenies of degree roughly 2 to the a. Second point is that you have the coordinates of some points on the shared curve in a canonical basis. So these are the two main differences between this computational Diffie-Hellman problem and the computational Diffie-Hellman problem in SIDH. The decisional Diffie-Hellman problem is not hard here, effectively because of these coordinates that are revealed. In fact, if you are given a random supersingular curve E dash and you want to check if E dash equals to EAB or not, then all you need to do is to generate the canonical basis on E dash and recover the corresponding points. If these corresponding points, if they verify the pairing equation with the canonical points RB, SB, and RA, SA, then the curve E dash is EAB with overwhelming probability. If not, then the curve E dash is not EAB as well. So this can be used to discard curves that are not the shared secret in the SIDH, in the Hill site instance. So the decisional Diffie-Hellman type problem for Hill site is not hard. Nevertheless, you will show how to derive a PKE scheme from Hill site. So now we present SHealS and HealS, the PKEs we derive from Hill site. So the key generation is the same. Now for encryption, the key generation is the same. For encryption, Bob will compute his part of the Hill site key exchange. And for a given plain text M here will be an integer modulo 2 to the 2a, and an integer which is co-prime with 2. Bob will scale the coefficient E3, F3, E4, and F4 by M, and X all of these with the hash of the G of the shared secret. Note that scaling these coefficients, since they are coordinates of point in some canonical basis, then scaling this coefficient is exactly scaling those points with the scalar M. And when you scale those points with the scalar M, since Alex can recompute those points in the key validation, then all she needs to do is to solve a discrete logarithm problem. And note that here we are talking about point of order 2 to the 2a, so the discrete logarithm problem is efficient with respect to the Polyhegman algorithm. So now during decryption, all Ali needs to do is to complete the Hill site, the underlying Hill site key exchange, then the decryption is essentially solving the discrete logarithm between phi a dash of RA and the points she computed during the key validation. When she computes M, since there are two points, when she computes M prime, M dash using one of the points, she checks if it is the same M dash which is obtained from the other with the other point. If it is the case, then she returns the coefficient, the integer M dash. If not, she aborts the decryption. Note that in SHealS, Bob is using torsion points of order 3 to the 2b. But since Bob does not run any key validation on Alice's public key, then Bob would use only torsion points of order 3 to the b. And so one can change the prime size to have a more efficient scheme This is what is done in HealS. So the public keys, the public parameters now are E0, P2, Q2, PB, and QB. And the scheme is exactly the same as in HealS. The difference between the two is that in HealS, both can always stay on the side of the tree isogenous, right? Regardless of whether he is like encrypting messages or he is receiving ciphertext that he needs to decrypt. And Alice also can always stay in the side of the two isogenies, regardless of whether he is encrypting messages or is receiving ciphertext to decrypt. While in HealS, Bob can only encrypt ciphertext using three isogenies. He cannot like receive ciphertext while using three isogenies. And in some contexts, this may be important, especially like, for example, in implementation, where you can have a device in which you only need to store the computation of three isogenies. You don't need to store both three isogenies and two isogenies. Now for the security, the INCCA security relies on the following problem, which consists of distinguishing a random basis of the shared curve and the real images of the torsion points RA and SA through the isogeny phi b dash. So here you are given, you have the first basis B0, which is made up of the images phi b dash RA, phi b dash SA of the torsion points RA and SA through phi b dash, and another random, uniformly random basis RS of the 2 to the 2A torsion group of EAB, such that the pairing equation for RS is verified. So the pairing R and S satisfy the pairing equation. Now, what the adversary is asked to do is to distinguish, given a random basis, is to distinguish if this basis is B0 or is just a random basis satisfying the pairing equation. For the INCCA security, we could not come up with an INCCA proof, but we also argue that we are not aware of any INCCA attack, any known INCCA attack on the scheme. One of the main reasons we believe could justify the reason why we could not come up with a proof is the fact that in the key validation method, we do not verify that Bob effectively computed an isogeny of degree 3 to the B. So there is no validation on the isogeny degree. Nevertheless, we counter all known attacks that exploit this weakness of the key validation. Now let's summarize the contribution of the paper. By comparing our schemes to existing ones. So HealS side, we compare HealS side with KSIDH, because KSIDH was the only existing countermeasure to the, so the only existing non-Fushizaki Okamoto transform countermeasure to the GPST adaptive attack when we were writing the paper. So we can see that the HealS side beats KSIDH side in terms of efficiency and parameter public key and private key sizes. In fact, in HealS side, you compute only four isogenies in the full execution of the key exchange, while in KSIDH side you compute up to K square, more than K square isogenies. Also, as well as KSIDH side, HealS side is compatible with static keys, but HealS side is not a non-interactive key exchange. So this is one of the main issue in HealS side. It's not a non-interactive key exchange. Another issue is the fact that you need a trusted setup for the starting curve, E0. So these are the two main drawbacks of HealS side compared to KSIDH. So now let's compare HealS and HealS to SIDH. HealS and HealS, they have larger parameters, But one of the interesting fact about the two schemes is that in SHealS and HealS, you compute only four isogenies, while in SIDH, you compute five isogenies are computed. So if one could come up with a better countermeasure, if one could improve on this countermeasure in such a way that either the field characteristic of the characteristic of the field used is reduced, like say we use by example the same primes as in SIDH or SIDH, then this will be very good. This will lead to a very great speed up on SHealS and HealS, and we may even have schemes that that try to compete with SIDH in terms of efficiency. So we believe that improving this countermeasure will lead to very nice public key encryption scheme or interactive key exchanges that have nice efficiency advantages. So as open problems, we have cryptanalysis. The key validation is new, so cryptanalyzing it is a good project. Can the key validation method be improved? There is in fact too much overheat in the key validation, and we believe it can be improved. And for this point, we are currently working on refinements of the key validation method, and we hope that the result we are having will be online in the upcoming months. The last open problem is the NCCA security of SHealS and HealS. So since it is only a conjecture, can we like contradict the conjecture, or can we like redesign the scheme such that we can like provide a proof, an NCCA security proof? That's it for my presentation. Thank you. And the paper will be online before the live presentation at the conference. Thank you for listening.